Any things you passed on that you wish you hadn't have passed on, that you were offered that you went, oh, I should have taken that?
There are several, but I can't remember what they were, but there were one or two I think I should have done, actually, but I didn't do it. I was always saying, another thing I love was stories about the German stories and Nazis and all that kind of stuff, World War II. But I never had an opportunity to do. I always wanted to make a German movie, but everybody else was having that opportunity to make these kind of movies. But I find them more kind of interesting.
Interesting.
I like walk and talk movies, mostly is what I did. I'd call them walk and talk movies.
You look at his films, you know, Bananas, Sleeper, the earlier films, you know, of course, which are made fun of in Stardust Memories, right. When he says, you know, we like your earlier, funnier films.
Look, here's my point. If nothing lasts, why am I bothering to make films or do anything for that matter?
We enjoy your films, particularly the early funny ones.
Well, he's not funny anymore. For that garbage?
Okay,
what self-indulgence?
Okay,
I think the man's lost his mind.
Look, we can take the film away from him. We can reshoot it. We can recut it. Maybe we can salvage
he's
something.
He's pretentious. His filming style is too fancy. His insights are shallow and morbid. I've seen it all before. They try to document their private suffering and fob it off as art.
What does he have to suffer about? Doesn't the man know he's got the greatest gift that anyone can have, the gift of laughter?
They are, you know, basically gag films. You know, Take the Money and Run as a gag film, right? You go from joke to joke to joke, and they're brilliant jokes.
Right.
And then in Love and Death, all of a sudden, which I don't think you shot, all of a sudden he starts to use the camera in a more meaningful way, for lack of better words.
Right.
What was that relationship like? How did you, I mean, did he look up to you? Did he, like, how did it?
That's when I started blocking for him, you know, discussing the way scenes could play in a room. And this, any suggestion about how, if you look at those movies, the way they move along and how he presents himself in and out of rooms and things and things, it was all the suggestions I gave him based on the blocking, you know, about how you should play a scene. See, before that, he would admit the fact that, you know, I just like to put the camera up and then I stand out front and we do it, you know.
Right.
Whereas blocking and a camera becomes an instrument of telling the story.
Right.
It's not simply, you know, the other way. So he began to understand that, and the use of close-ups and the use of no close-ups and the use of two shots and that's it.
Do you find it very hard to direct yourself?
Hard? No. I just have to resist the temptation to give myself too many extreme close-ups. Oh, I'm sorry. Forgive me. I'm in the wrong room.
No, you're right. This is your room. Isn't this fun? I mean, I tipped the porter so I could meet you.
Oh, Jesus. You're kidding. You're telling me they let you in here?
Well, I know. You get this all the time.
No, I don't.
No, but, you know, I have a psychic, and I asked her about you, and she told me that we were destined to make it together.
Whoever you are, please. I'm tired. Go away.
Well, last night I had a migraine, Anna, so I took some Darvon, and that made me so nervous that I took 40 milligrams of Valium, you know, and then I still couldn't sleep. I was up all night. Yeah, well.
But it was all based also on, you make that choice because what's the cut before this and what's the cut after that? What are you going to do before? It's like he'd come over with a script and say, what about this thing? And I turned the page. He says, no, back here. I said, I know that, but I just want to see what comes after this. I just want to see what comes after this,
so
this piece.
You were looking at flow from the macro perspective.
Yeah.
Okay, fine.
You have to. Yeah, the whole movie in your head all at the same time, plus what's going on at the moment, you know. So blocking is extremely important when you're making a movie, because you want it to deliver information. You want it to make in the shortest possible way, in the most effective way. So, look at a lot of movies now, nobody knows how to block. I mean, they don't know. Yeah. So.
It's fascinating because it's so fundamental. I mean, blocking, you know, it's a stage term, you know, and it's so fundamental to.
Well, camera blocking, you know, we do. I'd get the scene. There were three cuts. Okay, I'd lay all three cuts down, mark all three cuts, mark all the actors, send the actors away, and then I'd light primarily for most of it, except for the
Little things.
Little things.
Would you put in lights, you know, take two, take three, in between takes, just start putting things in, or would you wait for them to come back and do the scene again?
No, I was finished. They'd come back and sit down, and we'd have a tech rehearsal just for the sound people and everything, and then shoot. The close-up, then I'd make things, adjustments for the close-up or whatever, if necessary. I don't know.
You go to Make Manhattan, and then later Stardust Memories, and they're very different looking films.
Right.
You know, they're both black and white, but the similarities kind of end there.
Right.
Well, maybe there's some more, you know. But
yeah, right.
At the beginning of Stardust, you know, there's Woody Allen is stuck on the Bergman train, and he wants to be on the Fellini train.
Yeah, right. Was that the loser train?
He's on the loser train, and a very young Sharon Stone, I think, blows him a kiss through the window.
Yeah, right.
You know,
yeah, right.
At that point, who is she? Was that completely conscious? You're going to make one look like Bergman and one look like Fellini, and you're going to use those things through it? No, not even. It was just about the scene.
Not even close.
Okay, fine.
I mean, not to me. I mean, in his head, it might have been going wrong. He never, ever had any discussion about what something looked like in somebody else's movie with me, ever. And I never related to anyone else's movie. I just did what I thought
was right.
And then people would rush and say, gee, this is a very Bergman-esque thing. And I said, oh, no. I said, but I really, none of this had anything to do with that.
Why is it that in the 50s and 60s, movie heading into the 70s, really, I mean, I think 1968 is kind of the year that cinema changed.
Yeah.
But that it was so common to see very stagey lighting and, you know, basically triple shadows and quadruple shadows. And, you know, an example I've used previously is, you know, The Great Escape. It's a wonderful, wonderful movie.
Yeah,
I can watch it 100 times.
But,
you know, they walk into these cabins to confront the Germans and, you know, like there's shadows everywhere.
Right.
It just looks like they're on a set.
Right.
What changed that got rid of that aesthetic? Was it just advancements in technology and film stocks getting faster?
I changed a lot of it.
Well, thank you for answering that.
You know, I never really thought about the scene, a lot of these people. A lot of people did, and they did the best they could. And a lot of them did a really good job with it, actually, for the most part. But most of the thinking was, well, you know, this is so-and-so, she's so-and-so's in it, and then Steve is in it, and so-and-so's in it. So their first obligation, and this wasn't something, even if they thought about it, they didn't do it anyway. Their first obligation was first not to get fired, but the first obligation was to the studio to do things in a certain way that was
acceptable,
always the same, and why don't I look nice today, and you know, all that kind of crap.
So is it safe to say that the thing that the studio finds acceptable at the end of the day is based on, to be blunt about it, a male phallic insecurity, more is better, bigger is better.
Yeah, sure.
Throw up more and I know it's good.
Yeah,
you know?
A lot of it is that. A lot of it. And then, of course, you're dealing with contracts, you know, people, stars, you know, like Joan Crawford, you know, I dragged this cameraman around with her for a long time so she could look a certain way. And there was a funny story about her in the screening room after a day's work with him. And she's saying, I forget his name anyway, she says, Joe, I'm not looking so good now. And the cameraman says, well, I'm getting older. You know, so couldn't even. Now, there is a limit. You're not a plastic surgeon. You know, you can only do so.
I'm getting older.
Yeah. But the bottom line of it is, I mean that I changed it because I started redefining things based on what the story was, what was happening in the room. Plus, I looked at something, I thought, this is a nice way to do it. It had nothing to do with some
preconceived notion.
No, I thought, this is a good way to do it. But it was always hung on, but is it okay for this story? Or is it okay for this moment in this story? So I never thought, put a 10K over here and a thing. And I put plenty of 10Ks up for a lot of stuff, but not in the same
way.
So,
So let's talk about going right down the path of saying we can get away with this and we can get away with that, yeah, and we can do it. So right, two things to ask about The Godfather Part Two. There's one sequence, Pacino standing in a room with a mantle. And I think you were quoted as saying, I may have went too far, but that's okay because Rembrandt went too far a couple times.
I have said that stupidly. I may have said that, but...
No, I don't think it's stupid.
I have said, I was with a scene with Morgana King when he comes back to see his mother in the winter in the house there. And actually, see, one of the problems, what's happened a lot, technically speaking now, I'll talk, is what's happened is, first of all, Eastman Kodak can't make film anymore because they don't want to make film anymore.
Right.
But even when they were making it late in I always depended on repeatability. They made film stocks that I'd given away, and that was it. If I ordered something there, I always knew I was going to get that. Repeatability in labs was much better. That got really dicey after a while. And then the film got really dicey after a while. So you have all this crap going, you know, that you couldn't really define. Well, when I did a lot of those scenes, they were three strips. You know, they were printing three strip prints, Technicolor prints. So a black on a three strip print was black, you know, and you could take a thin line on the screen and you had it, you know. I mean, it was beautiful, actually. And your movie would look the same all over the world because they'd same matrixes go to Rome, London, and they print, and they'd have the same thing.
When you sat down to retime it for the Blu-ray...
Well, yeah, all of that said, well, the Blu-ray, luckily, a lot of stuff was saved because electronically because they had damaged so much negative and everything. But anyway, removing three-strip printing from the process made it more difficult to get what they originally looked like. And even dealing with these people later to electronically reestablish the movies, I still didn't get it back again.
Never got
back to the you know, the yellow thing. Yeah, it's there, but it's not there the way it was. So it's very difficult. And I don't know what Francis was doing, sipping drinks in the Bahamas or something, because he never really, you know, was like
that bum.
So the bottom line, you know, is you can't always, you know, depend on anything anymore.
Do you have any favorite, were you a wide lens guy? Were you a long lens guy? Did it just matter on the moment?
I was a 40 millimeter person, actually. In fact, Panavision made one for me because they had, like, you know, they'd go from 28 to 35 to some other obscure thing. I said, no, you know, I step into a room, a 40 is perfect. I mean, it's like, it looks very normal on the screen.
Right.
Normal. I said, that's what I want. So I've always seen everything. It's
sort of...
Can we
make sure that's at 40? I just want to just make sure.
Yeah, right. 40.
You're on 40.
Are you? That's very
funny. 150.
Yeah, right. That's good, too. But
he threw you a bomb.
40 is, you know, it's a normal... You look at it on the screen, it's, you know, you're not pushing anybody. You're not pulling anybody. It's, you know, it's there. I'm a sort of an eye level person. I see movies like eye level.
What is your name?
Come on, son. What is your name?
Tuo nome? Vito Andolini from Corleone.
Corleone. Vito Corleone.
Don't make a big thing about it. I knew it was you, Fredo. You broke my heart. You broke my heart.
Let's talk about a bit about Francis Ford Coppola. I mean, yeah, you described your relationship with Woody Allen very well.
Yeah.
How did you meet, and how did, and was it the same exact thing with Francis, where you were, if I may call him Francis, Mr.
Yeah.
Coppola,
yeah,
where you were really guiding and advising in terms of what essentially amounts to cutting?
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners.
Well, we didn't have the same kind of same kind of discussions, and the ones I did with Woody are really, they were very quick and on our feet. They weren't the in-depth thinking. They were just like bang, bang, bang. You like this? You don't like it? Boom, boom, and that was fine. Francis is a different kind of person, you know, and I think he did a wonderful job of extracting Godfather 1 from the book, because the book wasn't as good as the movie, in my opinion. So, I mean, he mounted what was good about the book on the screen. I give him huge credit for that. We didn't always get along because I deal in specifics. You know, I don't want to know about feelings or things. I deal in specifics. You got feelings, I want to know, you know. So, and I deal in, you know, layouts. You can't shoot unless you block a scene. You can't, you know, you have to know what you're doing.
Right.
And I was very instrumental in doing that all the time. And it was very frustrating to Francis, who sort of like, oh, let's jump in a car and go shoot him running around the field. So he still had this kind of film school thing.
Mentality.
Right. Good writer, but still, and he'll admit to it. He's like, you know, he still wants to run a studio and a film school. But, so we had a lot of problems that way.
Is there any advantage to having it, that sort of like, you know, free fall mentality to shooting? I mean, can it work for some pictures? Or, I mean, obviously it has in the past. There's got to be some pictures that you like that had a free fall.
It can work for some pictures, but yeah. It can't work for those kind of pictures, the one that he was shooting. You know, there's a, it had a lyric kind of narrative about it, and it had to be structured, and you had to shoot it, and you had to be able to cut it, and blah, 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 and all the rest of it, you know, see? But, I mean, if he saw Marlon Brando standing in the corner all made up as the Don scratching his ass, he'd want to rush over there and shoot it, you know? Well, I'm afraid not.
Right.
You know,
right.
Set it up and we'll shoot it, because, you know, but...
Couple of sequences I'd like to bring up that still to this day I think they're just so engrossing.
Yeah.
And your discussion already about the nature of cutting and blocking answered a lot of it. Ecco forte, non ci sento buono. Avvicinati. Il padre si chiama Antonio Andolini e questo è Petit.
I came home to vote in the presidential election because they wouldn't give me an absentee ballot.
and working with Alan J. Pakula, Pakula?
Pakula, yeah.
Pakula, okay.
Yeah, right.
That was, I mean, you're talking about director that made some tremendous thrillers with you.
Yeah.
All the President's Men, a thriller with very few guns.
Right.
It's riveting from beginning to end.
It is. How
much of it is about this long, long, long... You were talking about you lit with fluorescence. I mean, what about that movie works for you? I mean, obviously the story, but I'm saying, what about your work in it?
I'm very proud of that movie because every now and then I put it on, and I'll see what I mean. I can't see much now anyway, but I put it on, but the bottom line of it is, the reason I'm proud of it is it's all about delivering information. And I thought if this movie doesn't end soon, I'm going to go nuts. Because every shot, in principle, you were delivering information. You had to be delivering information. And when you look at it, we did a damn fine job of doing that and not make it...
Obvious
or rudimentary in some way. We kept it, you know, the structure and the shot structure on it.
Can you give an example of once it was, which is a piece of information and a piece of information, and it just...
Well, I can't because I can't remember all the information in it, but the bottom line of it is this scene where they're all trying to find out about this thing, and they finally rush to the elevator and tell Jason, blah, 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 and he says, okay, go ahead and print it.
He confirmed what happened. I said, if I get to 10 and you don't hang up, it's solid.
Did he confirm it?
Absolutely.
You gotta tell Brad. Bernstein got another source. The guy just is confirmed.
If there's any doubt, we can run it tomorrow.
You don't have to. The story's solid. We're sure of it. He just got off the phone with his gold.
Okay, we go with it.
Pasting all that together, that's another bad place to work in this newsroom because that got really oppressive. I don't know how anybody works in fluorescence all day long, but it was a juxtaposition of imagery became very important. The size of the imagery, what you cut to, what you didn't cut to, and still be able to, you know, deliver the information.
Right.
You told me on the telephone I came down and you showed me everything you got on Barker. That's all I want.
Well, that's what I've got.
Well, that's fine,
Okay, you and I are going to have an agreement that you're not going to reveal the source of your information. All these are cashier's checks on a bank in Mexico City.
All these checks from Mexico?
You see?
How come? Did money originate there?
Well, I doubt it started off as pesos.
Well, wait a minute, what's this one?
Okay, $25,000,
Was that Kenneth?
Kenneth H. Stahlberg. We haven't been able to ascertain who that is.
Bob, listen, I think I got something. I don't know what it is. But somewhere in this world, there is a Kenneth H. Stahlberg, and we got to get to him before the New York Times does.
And the other thing about the movie was, said to Alan, I said, you know, this feels like an in-depth movie to me, because this newsroom and everything that you have to see. You see a lot of things going on at the same time.
Yes.
So it seems like an in-depth movie.
Did you use a split diopter at any point?
Right. So I had some diopters built, actually, for that movie.
Oh, really?
And I had a holder built for them so they could be slid in and out during a shot. So the guy said, geez, you can't do that. I said, I'm going to. So we had scenes, you know, we're moving around the room and go this way, go that way, have marks on them, just slide them in. You didn't see it. And I had a shot on Bob on the telephone. I was making this long call with a lot of stuff going on in the background there. And that's where I actually had it built for. And we're zooming in on them like this. So and it just calibrated so that we're moving this in at the same time in order to maintain the focus on both ends.
You know? Wow.
You know, the assistant, the second assistant who, that was the dumb side of the lens. He had to, you know, push it in on Mark and the other assistant to take care of the focus. He didn't show up that day. They had to make that shot. He got scared that he wouldn't be able to do it. I did it.
He actually, you did it.
I did it. I did the diopter, and I fired him, but he couldn't. This is a Hollywood kid, you know.
Yeah.
His brain was.
was Gordon Willis? Was Gordon Willis tough to work for, or was he easy to work for?
I'm easy as long as you do your work.
Right.
I'm pretty easy to work for, actually.
Well, but you said earlier you don't want to know about feelings. You don't want to know someone's scared or feeling something.
Well, sure I do. If they're upset about something, I don't want them to be upset about it. I mean, that shot in the Library of Congress with Dustin and Bob going through all of these things, you know. Alan and I were trying to figure out what to do with this thing, and I said, well, you know, needle in a haystack. So we start right there, and then so we came up with the idea, how the hell do we do that? But if you go into the library, you look up at the dome, it's a dome, you know.
Yep.
And it can actually get up in there. So we put a winch up in there with a cable on it and an Aeroflex with a stabilizer on it. And we just started, you know, lifting the thing. I said, thing. So you see,
right, the brilliance. Yeah, yeah, this is what they're going to have to search through.
So
right,
we did it, and unfortunately, I had to do it twice because we didn't have any video then. So I had to figure it out on a piece of paper and then use taglines to fix it as it was going up.
Fixing, you mean focus or
no? The focus, we had radio focus for it, but to move the camera because it was not dead center, it had to move off this way. So we did it twice, and the second time was pretty good. Might have been better if we could have actually gone up a little bit faster. But if we'd used the whole move and tote, you know, we'd have been sitting there for 20 minutes, which is not good. But so we put a dissolve in the middle of it, too.
Well, it's a beautiful shot.
But it worked.
It worked beautifully.
It worked
beautifully. I was mentioning it before, but I just want to come back to it. Going down the path of how far can we go with what you were doing with light and with framing and with interiors.
Uh-huh.
Some of this movie is like, it's stunning. There's no person in the world is going to say
it. I'm glad you like it. That's great.
Well,
yeah. No, really. Yeah.
It's a stunning film. You know, it is so innovative and I mean, there's other, Hannah and Her Sisters is a relatable film. There's other films, there's other Woody Allen films that are relatable, but this was truly a tremendous, you know, achievement. Was part of you scared a little bit about going that far down the dim line? No, not even, no.
Well, you know, one of the things you learn, I mean,
because the latitude of the stocks back then was like,
yeah, but I know what they were.
Right.
And one of the problems is everybody's guessing with what, you know, one of the first things I did is I pick a stock to shoot the movie with, right?
Right.
Okay, I shoot this series of tests on this stock. which ran from Normal all the way down to Three Stops Under and Three Stops Over. Anyway, to make a long story short, you find out what the limits of the film stock are that you're, and the limits of the print stock you are, and that's how you calculate something. You have to know what a stop and a half under looks like on the screen when you do it, because you can't tell when you're standing there.
Right.
You know, it's your problem is your eyes make adjustment. They compensate for it. Film does it. You have to make it do what you want. So right. If you don't know how to make it do what you want, then you know, blah. So it's the same thing with all low key or high key or normal. You have to know what it's going to look like if you underexpose it by 2 or 1 or don't or normal or whatever you do to it. You know,
that's fabulous.
A preoccupation with my own mortality. These feelings of futility in relation to my work. I mean, just what am I striving to create anyway? I mean, to what end, for what purpose, what goal?
The shootouts in The Devil's Own, you know, that take place early on and later on in the movie.
Right.
There's some shootouts which are, you know, very
right.
kind of like you're not sure what's going on, but you follow everything so clearly.
Right.
Another moment from The Devil's Own, and I'm sure this probably isn't brought up a lot, but how did you deal with the fact that, you know, Brad Pitt's character staying in the semi-finished basement and he hides the documents or whatever it is, the microfilm, the money, whatever, under the subfloor of the bathroom.
Right.
And it's completely clear
right.
what he's doing.
Right.
And it's completely clear that Harrison Ford would stumble upon it.
Right.
And yet this is something that if I read it in the script, I would think, like, how are you going to show that? I mean, you're talking about a subfloor of a basement, you know. Like,
right. I told him we were setting up when Brad first arrived at Harrison's house, right? Gets out of the car and the gun and thing, walks up the porch and then looks in the window, and there is Harrison on the couch. Well, nobody knows what that is. So I told Paku, I said, you know, you better sit down with this paper and, you know, and sort of put it up. So when we're looking there, I said, no one is going to know what the hell he's looking at because
right.
this is just. You don't know what that is. Well, no, he didn't want to do it. So nobody knows what he's looking at, you know. And so he tells me, he says, I looked at this for 6 weeks. I didn't know what the hell was going on. I said, I told you. I said, you know.
Did you go back and shoot the?
No, it's in there. But, but you know, it's one of those things. Wishing something is going to change in your head, you know, when you know that it's not going to be, it won't work, you know.
Right.
So don't.
The IBD, the internal bullshit detector.
Yeah, yeah. You're there. You know, it's 5 minutes.
Just right.
Do it.
Just yeah. get the shot.
Yeah, right.
Any regrets?
No, I don't think so. I mean, I think the only regret I have is that maybe it could have lasted longer, but not really. I don't know.
Well, let's talk about that because I was going to say, you did something which is very atypical, which is that, you know, most cinematographers, at least within the last 30 years, they sort of get viewed as peaking in their 50s, for whatever that means. They can do beautiful work in their 20s, they can do amazing work, you know, and then they sort of ride that wave as one of the sort of the old guard, while new kids are considered new fresh, whatever, into their 70s. Right, and then sometimes they for whatever reason bow out or whatever, you know. You, Mr. Willis, sort of said, you know, 64, 65. I don't know the exact age, but you went, I'm done. See you later.
Well, I was done actually. I didn't see I got tired of waiting in the rain for actors to come out of their trailers. You know, I really got tired of all that. But, and then you run out of people.
Right.
The kind of directors who, you know, have an elegant head on them and know how to tell stories, they began to die or disappear or quit.
Right.
And then you can work if you want to, but if that's the essence of your day, it's not good.
Screw it.
So I just didn't, it wasn't there anymore. So I figured, well, it's been good anyway.
Well, it was a graceful end to a tremendous, tremendous career.
Yeah, great.
I can't thank you enough for your time.
Yeah, my pleasure.
It's inspiring to hear your words, hear your thoughts. Pleasure to meet you.
You didn't eat any donuts.